Hey everyone, BJ Korros. This is the Hollywood Moment at Home Edition. And today our special guest is Tracy Reiner. Tracy, how are you doing today?
I'm great, BJ. Nice to see you and thanks for having me. I'm sitting in an attic in snowing outside. Yeah.
Well, it's interesting because truly it's like fire and ice because it's fire out here in California and it's ice near you. So what a perfect combination right now, right?
Yeah, my mom used to go to the fire and ice ball all the time.
One of the memories that you have of your mom going to that event?
What are they?
Lots
of dresses and, you know, her girlfriends would come over and they'd get all dolled up and it was a big deal. I only went 1 year.
Did you? What, do you remember the year you went? Were you working on a movie project at the time?
I was younger. I think I right after I did Die. It was a long time ago.
After Die Hard, though?
Yeah.
It's exciting because you've got a great auction coming up, all in celebration of the legacy of your mom, Penny Marshall, and it's going to be on September 13th. How's it been to make this such a living legacy through artifacts of your mom?
With very limited options, it's become a real exciting event. We're doing what we can right now before anything gets even crazier. And there's some really beautiful things that I can't possibly keep in my own personal life. So if you are a lamp lover or a obscure art lover, please take a look and I hope everyone enjoys it.
You are one of those amazing artists that continues the legacy of your parent and you've got something to be extremely proud of. It's hard, I guess, to let some items of your mom go, but at the same time, to show the appreciation and the love and let the world to have a piece of your mom forever. That's got to be exciting to you with the upcoming auction.
It's the stuff that she sort of had delegated. It's up to you. Do you want 150 lamps or do you want to? Because they're glass, because I have 10 animals and kids, we've already lived over a decade carefully walking through my mom's beautiful landscaped house.
Right.
That was a museum. So some of these are the things that I think belong in other people's collections or are overwhelming. There is no lamp god. There's no one who could handle that but her and all those light bulbs and the bill for lighting all of those lamps is sort of overwhelming. And I wish that there was like, oh, you just didn't know about this guy. But we've looked for 10 years about what to do with the lamps. And she gave some to her friends and she's, you know, everybody's sort of gotten to figure it out with us over the last 10 years. But this is a lot of lamps.
Now, categorizing the lamps and learning more about the history of the artist, how did you go about doing that?
I was incredibly fortunate to be dragged around the world with my mother and Carrie Fisher to London and Paris, flea markets and antiquarians and all of these different places. I worked on at Chicaboom, which was a store on Melrose years ago.
Right.
At like 15, they let me work there so that I would, you know, hopefully for them, they wanted me to own an antique mall. But that's all, again, I don't have brothers. I need to get a brother for that. But for years, it was going to be maybe I bought too much stuff.com or her and Carrie at one point, we're going to do a museum, Laverne and Leia's Kitsch or something. You know, we hadn't quite got the name, but it was really hard. And Debbie Reynolds really tried for decades to keep her collections alive. And then I'm from a family that all collected. Everyone collected something. Rob collected Hopalong Cassidy for years and old rock stuff. My mom and Carrie had the most collections, but like you remember Allie Willis and Paul Rubens have amazing collections. Jay Leno called after my mom passed and was like, what darling are you going to do? People who might be able to help you along the way, hold stuff, move stuff, store stuff. The LA Sports Museum man, Garry, was the hero for the last few months because in the midst of everything, the world shut down.
Right. And that makes it hard, too, when you're dealing with a world that's in a different state of mind as well. But we're all getting so nostalgic right now. And it seems like for people that may have not have known you or your mother or Carrie Fisher up until COVID, does it not blow your mind the new resurgence of all of you guys, plus many more, whether it be Gary, that people are seeing the great works that came from a very, very talented generation that included your mom and Carrie?
It was a close group of friends, really. Everybody kind of grew up. My uncle bought Debbie Reynolds' house at the beach, and everybody, even when my mom and Rob split up, he hired Carrie to come do When Harry Met Sally and me, and it was a clan.
Right.
It was a real era of almost like ensemble. You grow up and come up together, and you know, I'm not as bravado as some of them. My right. punk rock was to like cry in a bunch of movies. but you know, it's something that they brought attention to art forms that really needed to have closer look, you know, make you think kind of things. At first it started like everyone else, which was just sort of a kitsch. Let's bring back the past, keep the past alive. And then they got into more like statement art.
Right.
You know, and some of that is I would like help carrying on some of that, especially the lamps. Most of
the lamps are only just one part of Penny's collections too, because
this is not all of it.
Right.
This is barely a sliver. This is the stuff that needs to go into other people's collections. This is the stuff that needs to go to real lamp collectors, not just, you know, an estate sale kind of thing.
Right.
And I don't know anyone who had that space. I've been talking to all kinds of people saying, what do you think I should do with the lamps? But she had military art, she had folk art, tramp art, you know, record collections. There's still so many more. And some of them are gonna go to universities. Some of them are gonna go to be studied. Some of them are still gifts to people, things like that, so.
I love that. Now, tell us a little bit about some of the items that are going to be up for auction.
Like the execution in process sign. There's a lot of advertising art that's really amazing. The Daily News found a Daily News cart that, you know, newspapers used to be stacked on. So I said, you should have it. My uncle worked there years ago. And it's the kind of thing that's sort of a specialty now. It's not like all the shops on Melrose are still there. Things that I grew up going to all the time have since closed down. So it's really, you know, it's a grown-up specialty art collecting forum.
Now, was there one particular lamp or several lamps that are going up for auction that Carrie and Penny fought over who was going to get it and who was going to keep it?
No, this isn't their joint collection. This is just my mom's, but there was subject matters, like they both started to collect boats at the same time, and it came like Carrie went into kind of funkier boats, my mom went into military boats, and there were just this boat theme. And then there was a Donald Roller Wilson painting that my mom had left to Carrie, and it's so huge and it's such an intense conversation that I've already had for over 30 years,
right?
I think that it needs to go, and I'm not the one to represent that conversation, if you know what I mean. I got to be a part of everybody you can name discussing it over the years, but it's something that I really want to, you know, it needs to go bigger places.
And what's your thoughts on that particular piece?
My thoughts on it? It's a little haunted. It's got some funny, it needs to be somewhere appropriate for those discussions. My house now with my Malamute and my cat, my mom's was sort of a show house. It was different having parties and just having discussions like that for hours.
Right.
But I don't know. What do you think of it?
I think it's a very interesting piece, to be honest. And to me, I think you're so right about that it has to go to the right home, and it's got to go to a wall that just focuses strictly on it too, I feel.
Yeah, I mean, what do you collect? Do you collect anything? Look at their background. Is that
thank you. Collect some Disney Anna, some Star Wars, some various different things over the years. Clothing's actually kind of a hobby of collecting as well.
Yeah. With
obviously, good friends of your all's, Debbie Reynolds, love collecting clothing.
They taught me how to shop. And now I was in Albuquerque, so this is about as dressed up as I get now. But I had an amazing time learning from glamorous, glamorous women that, you know, put it on, but keep yourself.
Right. Isn't that true? But your mom also collected very simple things like Beanie Babies. How did her mother for Beanie Babies?
Converse tennis shoes, magnets, snow globes, different pins, a lot of Converse. She gave my daughter her Converse and sparkle tennis shoes. She has a lot of like Chinese outfits. I'm not sure. There are a lot of Chinese outfits. And most of the stuff, you know, I was with her getting over the decades. And so there's stuff that I kept that's really personal. Ribbon ladies for years we collected, and silhouettes and quilts. And then she had the largest personal sports collection.
Right. And that's what's so fascinating, because when you think about your mom, people do not know the multifaceted dimensions of your mom. What are some of those dimensions that you hope to continue that legacy? Because she could talk about anything and had a love for about everything. Is that correct?
She was the most like prolific reader. She had 7 books going at once, and she'd finish them all, and she'd record shows, not just on a one of those boxes, but like burn the disc, date it, label it in order every episode. Some of it, I don't know. There's so many things. There's 53 different categories we figured out.
Wow.
And so
that's amazing.
And antique jewelry and military art, bullet art, injured animal art, a lot of World War II art, a lot of music. She was fell in love with musicians and traveling and things we got there. We had a huge travel t-shirt collection for, I mean, some really simple things that are really fun. And then some, you know, Handel, Pierpoint, Jefferson, Tiffany lamps that were all one of a kind, extraordinarily made, handmade stuff. She really liked people who did it for real.
So is that how, other than the fact they worked on a film together, obviously, but how Rosie and your mom became best friends as well?
Rosie and my mom how to handle a large group of people.
Right.
So after League of Their Own, they got offered those Kmart commercials.
Great gifts for each one on your list. Cool CDs, VCRs and TVs, Kmart's got. Yes, low prices, how smart. Ah! On entertainment, get games, movies, all the big names, DSS, 200 channels, no less.
Teaching Rosie how to shop too. So those kind of things, they'd do the commercials, love them, and then ask for like a lot of money in items, and we'd get to go through and just kind
shop
of
away
Kmart. And so, you know, when I had a son, I had diapers and clothes and tennis shoes, you know, and that was really amazing. And they became friends because it's like they host well.
Right, right. There's no question about that. And speaking about hosting well, 6 degrees of separation. Does the date December 13th, Chicago?
Okay.
Okay, the Rosie Show?
Were you there?
I was there. Invited guest, myself with the Candy Queen, Brenda Murphy. And what a special, special tribute to your mom. And, you know, I'm going to give you a blast to the past here a moment.
Oh, we had a really fun time.
I don't know. I'm going to
Okay, that's my girls and my ex-husband and my son was in the back room, wanted nothing to do with it.
Right, I remember this. But to be able to celebrate a legacy of your mom with Rosie on The Rosie Show on OWN.
So now you have one daughter, Tracy, and you have some grandkids.
Yes.
Three?
Three.
Three. And how was that for you? Was it like a whole new experience?
Well, Spence I love. He's 19. He's 19. From a different relationship.
Right.
Well, we're right after league. She got pregnant.
Exactly.
Her and Megan
got pregnant.
That's
all right.
All the women may had showers and crocheted them and knitted them thing. And now she's with Matt, who's married, and they have two little girls, Bella, who's 6, and Viva, who's 5.
Really? And when they heard we were doing this, they said, can we be there? And I said, sure. So here they are.
Where?
Yeah, they're right here. Just like one of those big surprise shows.
Look
at that! Hello, Tracy!
Hello. Really bright, you flowers.
Look, you got flowers. Hi, girl.
Good. Maybe you guys would...
How are you, Trace?
I'm fine.
Good to see you.
You look fantastic.
How are you?
Oh my gosh, look at these beautiful
Viva,
children.
Spencer's here. Really he's like. Mortified and backstage.
He is? He doesn't
he
want to come
nothing.
Out? He's same he as Parker, 17?
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. He's 19.
19. Yeah. Oh, dear Lord. So. Now, you brought a gift for Grandma. What'd you bring?
That's got to be special, too, because your mom's collection was put in the limelight just by pictures and photographs for the most part. And some of the key landmarks of her career, whether it be big.
For Josh Baskin, life was a little unfair. Until he made a little wish.
I wish I were big.
Sweetheart, it's 7:30. Are you up? Josh!
20th Century Fox presents Tom Hanks. Big.
I turned into a grown-up, Mom.
Or A League of Their Own. It's got to be exciting to see that type of history of your mom to live on. Not only Laverne and Shirley.
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Schlemiel, Schlemazel, Haas and Beff Incorporated.
We're gonna do it.
Give us any chance, we'll take it.
Her other works that she's such
a woman director.
Yeah. Right.
It's she kind of did more than most so far.
Right.
She crossed over and did things and wasn't the righteous feminist that everybody kind of wanted her to be. She really is very co-ed and very much a team player and always worked with people. She said, you got to hire people much better than you.
Right.
To get anything done and then celebrate them. And so, you know, I was lucky enough to go on those adventures with her. And I don't know that I could have handled the diplomacy of some of those battles that she did.
Right.
But, you know, for her peer group, her world of coming up and coming out and doing her own thing, I don't know anybody who's done as much. And so I'm ridiculously proud. I only spent a few, we were thinking like, I was only away from my mom for like 10 years when my dad and her split up as a kid all the way up to the last few years that I was there. I was right there. And so I'm trying to work and keep a lot of her different endeavors alive, a lot of the work with the women's baseball.
Right.
In 30 years, 29 countries have decided to fund girl and women's baseball in their countries. And then I have to throw in, but not one state. But we're getting there. Major
right.
League Baseball seems to think that they can make a dollar now and they're going to fund girls' camps and, you know, slowly full immersion, slow process to full immersion, we hope. And that was amazing. That really changed the whole trajectory of my life.
Now, the reboot of A League of Their Own, is this something that you're a part of?
In the sense that they came to the celebrations that they did in Cooperstown and in Rockford, Illinois for my mom and wanted to know, and we talked to them. We stayed up until about 4 or 5 in the morning one night, me and the writers just going over things that they wouldn't have the instinct to know unless they'd had made a baseball movie.
Right.
Not about the comedy, not about the characters, but just some logistics that could really destroy them if we didn't give them a heads up. And a lot of things to think about. And I'm excited. I'd like to see, you know, we always wanted there to be more dimension. They only offered my mom to do more dimension of the league into Jimmy Dugan.
Right.
She said, I didn't make that movie about women to give them jobs to make a movie, another movie with Tom Hanks about Jimmy Dugan. So it's a slow process, but it's still one of the coolest things I've actually seen materialize from a movie.
And your role in the movie, I mean, it is truly a great role for you. And we gotta say, nepotism is a great thing for you and your family. And we love that there's so much talent within your family that you can cross over, whether it be your uncle's film or your grandfather's film or whoever's film, that you could be a part of it.
They realized like I was a utility player. It wasn't something, I didn't want to be the lead in anything that much. I tried when I was younger, but I'm not a vampire. I'm pretty invisible.
Right.
And I like that. But I got to do some incredible films.
Until one boy.
I didn't have a boy, I had a girl.
Changed everything.
No, we had a boy. So he's gonna grow up and be just like me.
From director Penny Marshall. Comes the story of a girl.
It got in my mouth.
Whose dreams took an unexpected turn.
What's one bad day, right?
One day can make your life.
Drew Barrymore.
Mommy's gonna go do something that's gonna change the rest of our lives.
Riding in cars with boys.
How do I look?
You look beautiful, Mommy.
I had an Apollo 13. I had an uncle who really worked on Apollo 13 at NASA. I got to give him my t-shirts and stuff.
Bother you that the public regards this flight as routine?
There's nothing routine about flying to the moon. I can vouch for that.
Launch control, this is Houston. We are go for launch.
The clock is running.
Houston, we have cleared the tower at 13:13.
So I've had extraordinary experiences, and so now I kind of want my real life to get as extraordinary.
Get that balance back, right? Be extraordinary and great and keep a balance.
For real, not just simulating it, yeah.
But at least you married a military hero.
Excuse me. I got a telegram from one of you ladies from the War Department.
Oh my God, Ernie.
Let's see. Boy, I hate these. These are the worst. At least the Army can do is send someone personally. Tell your husband's dead. Darn, I had the name right here. Well, now I gotta go back and get this straightened out. Sorry.
Hey, just give me the telegram.
I can't. I don't have a name on the checklist.
Just give me the telegram.
Hey, this is official. This is from the War Department. Come on. That's official business.
Sorry, Betty.
No, John! No.
Real life to a military hero as well.
He was a Coast Guard, and we actually found out we were second cousins when we did our ancestry.com from New Mexico, by marriage, not by blood.
Right.
And, I, you know, Barry Sinise way more than me, but took those roles kind of serious because of the interaction that you get after. And I have a lot of family members who had worked at Los Alamos, or who participated in the wars, worked at Los Alamos, India Labs, Kirtland Air Force Base, NASA. And so when people would come up to me at the card shows, they would be like, oh, Megan, you're so funny. Oh, Laura, you play Belle so well. Oh, Rosie. And then they'd go, oh, let me tell you about the day my mother got her letter about my uncle or brother or father. And it gives you a whole different perspective on what's important and what your impact is. And, you know, it, I got to meet Mary Hayes, who was the woman I played in Apollo 13, and she had as many astrophysics degrees as her husband and was a master archer and was the only woman in NASA to have a shag. And I said, oh, I'm sorry, they gave me this kind of Jackie O flip, but she was really powerful, you know? And so I got to meet, because of my experiences, some really incredibly intelligent people. And I'd sort of been around entertaining people my whole life.
Right.
So it changed me. And I have a son who's got a very engineer mind. They kind of got that side of the family. Only one daughter perhaps will be a writer, but my kids weren't that into the ta-da-ta-da. And so it's now in a more interesting and thought about way, I'm trying to figure out things that I'd like to keep going for my mom that were really part of her, not just who everybody thought Penny was.
What do you feel your favorite role or the most important role for you personally, for yourself, in growing up and being on film?
That I got to grow up in real life without having to be on film as well. That was my only job, is to grow up, not to have to go do film. So I got to have a little bit of both. I was always, if I had to choose between the TV show when I was 12, 13, or my pony, I chose my horse. Mm. And then I would get to go and do all these things with my mom, but I got to see what she liked and didn't like. And, you know, when you get too much of an insider view, it's not fair to bombard people. I just like the things that I like. I like the people that I've gotten to work with, and I don't know. I like my life.
That's a good thing, especially in this day, to be able to say you like your life, and you may even say you love your life, probably. It's got to be a good feeling.
Now, yeah. I got to have such a great time running around as everyone's like, my mom was really young when she had me.
Right.
So, you know, I'm older.
but
my kids now.
You know what's interesting, too? You talk about your mom being a team player, but all the Marshalls were team players. And one thing that Garry loved doing the most is playing softball and keeping everybody as a unit and as a team. Did you play softball with your uncle and all the cast when they had cast softball tournaments?
Years ago, Happy Days and Laverne and Shirley and a couple, I think Tony Danza came once from Taxi. They all shot at Paramount. So my father, my birth father here in New Mexico, was director of state of the New Mexico Special Olympics. So way back, even in the 70s, on Happy Days, we would do exhibition softball.
Right.
And then there was also this other league that Rob and my mom played in, a celebrity softball thing at parks in the Valley. And then we would go to Hawaii with like Harvey Korman and Lawa. There's a whole like Carol Burnett group of people and Tim Conway and Artie Johnson. I remember all these people who were friends. And then there was that it was softball, but the Reiners were very into tennis, which is similar. So I had all this tennis in my world growing up, like the Merv Griffin and Carl Reiner and Mel Brooks tennis tournaments in like La Costa or Venice. And so it was about being a verb. You had to keep moving and play board games and collect. And what was your thing? You know, finding all the things you could do was a big deal. And my cousin played much more than me. Originally, another director was going to make League of Their Own, but my mother was producing it. I had just gotten my wisdom teeth pulled. So when she said, I'm nervous, there's all these actresses there, I was like, I'll drive, I'm on medication. Well, I drove her to USC. There were 2,000 girls in spandex and like Adidas tennis shoes. And I said, I'll do this with you. Don't worry, how hard can it be? We've all played softball, you know, we're athletes. And then we forgot we had separate last names, so we got separated. She was an H and I was an R. But when we got home, I thought my mom had heard that I'd popped all my stitches and like, and perhaps sucked. But we actually tested in the top 20, 25 girls. And that made her say, wait a minute. If my kids can do this, then there's a Serena Williams of baseball.
There you go. There you go. You know
what I mean? If we could even be remotely that okay, let alone actually do well, that was fascinating to her. That's like, you know, wait, my dog jumped through the fire hoop? Wait, what? we just give him pickles and treats. So she was really excited that we could do that. And some things happened and then it turned around and I think the studio said, you have to make it or we're gonna sell it. And we had already trained and did all this, so she said, do you wanna do it? We're gonna do this movie, I'm gonna make it. And I was like, wow, okay. let's do it
right.
And you know, it's
interesting because your uncle Garry was at the 70th anniversary for the Television Academy, and that probably was one of his last big appearances, and he was with all the iconic actors and actresses that had performed in those seven decades. What's kind of one of those memories for you about your uncle?
He was a hero of mine. He was very subtle, but he would always know what I was doing and watch things and hear about whether it was auditions or I heard you wrote something. Or him and Carl would show up at strange things that I did trying to do my own thing, and be really supportive. You know, he said, you're much smarter than you are funny, so you're not going to have as much fun. But my joke back to him years later, but I cried in like 26 movies and made a nice buck. That's pretty funny.
That is pretty funny.
Pretty funny coming from our family. I think that kind of worked out. And he let me know if I had questions about something, if he knew about it. He didn't go, oh, just ignore that. He'd show me or send me. I used to read for his theater, and he'd send things my way that I'm sure wasn't going to be a play at the theater.
Right.
And he'd say, could you read this for me? And I just want you to give me good notes I could say back to them. But I want you to know what it's about. And I'd go, wow, okay. And some of the trails of King Solomon's mines all the way back in time. Really, you want me to read this? He always encouraged me to be smart, not pretty.
Right.
Because you could do that. You could act. You're cute. You could do that. Don't make your life too complicated. And you don't have to do everything we do.
Beautiful. That really is beautiful. You know, I think one of those memories that Garry and I talked about it several times, but I think one of those memories that resonates to me the most is always having your aunt somewhere in one of his pictures.
All of us are in his pictures. Everyone.
At some point, right?
All of us, the dog, everyone, they call out names in airport scenes of his wife or kids or things like that. And yeah, he made sure I did a lot of movies with Garry. I did 9 with him. I did 9 with Tom Hanks. I did less with my mom and Rob because they wanted me to be on my own. Right. But they also brought me along and showed me and said, you'd be good at this. They'd always tell me, you know. Because I'd learned to fit in, and that kind of lost me after a while. But at the same time, I've gotten to do like way too many amazing things.
Right. Now, is there one particular film project or TV project that you were a part of with your mom? Did you like it more as her directing or in the project with you as well?
Awakenings. At one point it was between me and Penelope Ann Miller. There were a couple of us that looked nothing alike. It made no sense. Like Jennifer Grey and Mariel Hemingway and you know, Penelope Miller and me. They kind of didn't know what they wanted. But she decided to dye my hair blonde. She really wanted me to do it. We dyed my hair blonde so I didn't look Italian like Robert De Niro. And I was a little right there at that height with him. So I had to kind of squish my knees. And we left it up to the studio. And then in the end, they were like, Penny, do you want Penny or Tracy? And it was okay because they were going to shoot in a mental institution for a really long time in the winter. I never took it personally. Right. But that movie got started.
I talk to people.
You work here?
No, I live here.
You don't look like a patient.
I don't?
Girls.
You're not married.
Me?
Would you like to go out for a cup of coffee?
Affected our whole lives as well. My grandmother had Alzheimer's, and so the investigation into the brain and how it works with Oliver Sacks and the development of Awakenings, and then the real, you know, 3-hour version uncut, which drops you to your knees and is so profoundly moving, and her to, you know, be able to take Robin Williams, who we knew my whole life, right, pretty much since I was little anyway. The adults knew him in their adult life, but I knew him since I was a kid and his kids. And so it was, she took them somewhere and neither of them had ever gone. And I was so impressed at that story and the performances, and, you know, they'll never acknowledge an Italian woman, but I think she got as close to saying, no, I'm also an incredibly serious, smart, intelligent woman. Perhaps you'll like this film.
Right. And do you feel that with Alzheimer's, we've made a lot more progress? And is that one of the charities that you also support regularly?
At different points we have, it's each person, you know, has come up with some ailment we sort of give to that. My mom passed from more diabetes. There's all kinds of arranged donations. For me, it has to do with changing the notion that planned obsolescence is still a good thing for this country, because we don't take care of our health. Right. We don't promote it. We don't protect it. So to me, it was part of that and that generation and a lot of aluminum and different things that cause it. And there are not a lot of choices sometimes. But it's all possible. If we can put it in a movie.
Right.
We can be millions of dollars for it to be in a movie. Perhaps we can do some of this for real now. And that's sort of my goal.
So when you talk about putting it into a movie and a focus and your goals today, what are your goals today?
Well, the joke years ago was there should be shopping for peace.
I love it.
A leader has a woman, a wife, a girlfriend, an aunt, a sister, you know, and they could literally stop deficits with the appropriate group of female shoppers. And it would be world peace because you can't kill world leaders' wives. And I thought we all would laugh and thought that was a really simple way to solve it. Instead, people sort of want to shop on the moon or something. But right now, my focus is a lot of the organizations for veterans, retired athletes, traumatic brain injury, autism. I'm working on a signal that I've been working with. I became the president of the Women's Club of Hollywood right as I was moving. But my mom lived in Charles Toberman's house, who was a very famous old Hollywood icon. And Scarlett O'Hara was chosen at that house. And he helped build Post 43 Hollywood on Highland. And then the Women's Club was started by like the DeMille daughters. And apparently Charlie Chaplin was a teacher there. And it was sort of a school and somewhat of a boarding house. And it's one of the oldest women's club in California. And so there's some responsibilities for all the things that have come out and gone down and are still sort of going on that I'm going to help participate in, because I think that's an untapped voice. I think it probably went, oh, what do we do for a while? But we've helped the club get saved out of bankruptcy, and it's sort of a giant microphone ready to be spoken into now. And that was my help to them. I don't want to be the voice of it, but I'm helping them launch.
But you've worked on a documentary for Post 43 to for Hollywood.
That, oh. We started to do a decade by decade, not right. That I think of Ken Burns, but decade by decade look at the relationship between Hollywood and the military.
Right.
And so that's still out there. It's a really long process, but it's out there. And then I was working on a signal, like I was saying, for these organizations, so that if you have any sort of special need, hopefully just attaching it to some of the handicap placards. They don't need me to go big organization. I think they have all the elements that they need to create a signal that you need to approach with special care, that this is a circumstance that is not approach with caution. This is a approach with compassion and care, special circumstances. So whether you're autistic, whether you have any sort of special need, whether you have traumatic brain injury, PTSD, you know, you name it, any sort of handicap, that pause. So there's not mistaking, you know, a 6 foot 23 year old boy whose grandpa is older taking care of him and a car alarm goes off and he has an episode. It looks like he's beating up the grandpa, and it's not that case. So there were a lot of ways in our creative family, you weren't allowed to just run commentary without having the solve. You couldn't say, I don't like that. So this is the area where I figured out I could create a solve that I don't own. I'm not trying to make merchandising for. I think each police department has their group of already applicable in need, you know, citizens and things like that, where it's just, it can be international. Nobody has to own it. Every city has it already kind of set up. They just haven't looked at it all the way through this way.
Tracy, I love this. How can we help you make this a bigger mission and give a shout out for a cause to get people more involved and join you with this mission?
That's what we're trying to figure out, because I'm not trying to be the identifying press release of it. I've been talking to different police unions. I've been talking to the American Legion. We're trying to see, well, or should they do it through national? Should we do it? I'm learning who some of the administrative people in a city's community is. And I don't know many of those people. I met a lot of them through the American Legion in Los Angeles, but now I'm in New Mexico. So I know certain people here, the head of the board, the school board and things like that. But it's something that needs to be universal, and that's a big one. I'm not sure. I'm learning legislatively on who and how to bring up things like that too. People who, like congresswomen, we got to play in a softball, the Congressional Women's Softball Tournament last summer, Megan Kavanaugh and I, Marla Hooch from League of Their Own, with 14 Republican and Democratic congresswomen, and the entire Congressional Journalists Women's News Corps. They were the other team. Like, who, Nancy Pelosi's like, do you want my hot dog? I am not prepared for circumstances like that. And as thinking about it, this was like the only thing I had that might be interesting to people like that.
I love it.
So it puts you in an interesting, like, what do we talk about in a different, you know. It was amazing. That was an amazing experience that I would offer myself up to anytime.
As we start to evolve and get back to normal, where the theaters, we can see people in the theaters again, it'd be great to see you come to California and go to Hollywood Post 43 and show one of your mom's films and have a Q&A there and help support the veterans at an event like that as well. I think the world would love it.
Yeah, no, they have a beautiful 1,000-seat theater now. At the time we were helping them, they were still in the process of getting built. And there's a whole new perspective, I hope, happening. And that a lot of the ideas that we had brought to the Post, we went for help, but we ended up helping them do this project. And it's just, important. It's just important to look at things. And I think that documentary is really necessary. I am a product of that.
Right.
And it was a fascinating adventure to be in an environment where I didn't have to explain to somebody why these two sides of my family were already connected in a weird way that, you know, nobody was going to tell me when I was seven. But over the years, like I went to see Star Wars and when I was 13, I think, at the Directors Guild. And then I went to visit my grandmother in southern New Mexico and told her about the movie. And she just said, oh, we gave him that. We, Cindy Lambs, gave George Lucas Industrial Light and Magic, I guess. 20 years later, I'm like, oh, is that what she meant? A lot of that simulator technology did go into special effects. I'm on the board of the 3, 4, and 5D Film Festival with some friends who run it. I intrude every time I can. Because I've, since the 70s, was obsessed with hologram. I've been trying to work with some museums to, depending on what level of actual immersive appearance we can have at a theme park or a museum, we're going to have to come up with some other ways to interact. And if you can't, travel bans and things, it's how can a kid in Cincinnati see the Louvre?
Right.
So that technology like that is fascinating to me because it's kind of clean, it's educational, and or medicinal, let's say, as opposed to just like, you know, special effects. And those are my peers who do those effects. Those are my, a lot of them are my friends. And so I like to stick my nose in and make sure we're not, that everything's kind of, can be good too. Like, can be amazing and not just destroy your psyche and program you, you know?
Now, when you talk about holograms, did you have the opportunity to see Whitney Houston's hologram yet for her concert?
I've seen the examples of like Tupac and Whitney. And at one point there was a company we were going to see if we could help Bernie Sanders go to Coachella because it's hot and he's older and he could go. And, you know, my mom was big on, like, she would love this.
Right.
Anything you could do from your bed, comfortably.
I love it.
There's a technology called the Beam, and I hosted 3 or 4 parties at Sundance a few years ago where I was rolling. I was in my house, just drinking wine in my house, but I could roll around these parties at Sundance, and they could put their business card in and text me and talk to me, and it was recorded, and I was robotic hostess.
I love it. I love it. When you talk about big, and particularly we got to put the pun in for your mom and the movie Big, I got to ask, are you going to put Zoltar up for auction or are you going to keep it purposefully?
What happened was when the world stopped, they stopped the forwarding of the Academy Museum.
Right.
So we had been talking and we were going to have a thing and now they don't know what to do. And they're like, we can't really store it here. So calls went around. Where should Goldtar go for a minute? And he goes, I'm in Albuquerque doing a movie. You're into, okay. So we didn't know what to do. So I found a place for Zoltar until he can do his Academy run at the museum. Or Zoltar's already been on a press tour. He got to go with the movie and a couple times go to Germany and other places. And I know there's a
Chicago. He was in Chicago when you all did the tribute on the Rosie Show for your mom as well.
So he's got a passport, and I don't want to just give him away or so because we haven't quite finished celebrating.
No, there's no way to. And the irony is now, sadly, so it's almost like you could interface several of your family members and keep celebrating as well. And that's something that's somewhat special that you're able to be able to do too. And add along with Carrie too, you know, I mean, why not, right?
I don't know that I'm the host of that party, but.
I think you would hold a good hostess seat though.
I would definitely go and sit next to the person who wanted to cover that. But it's been a lot of punches, you know? And for me, my real audience of icons is not here to talk about some of this stuff with me. And that's been daunting. And it doesn't go for just people who are around. I'm sort of went out there with them all for a while.
Right.
And if you didn't go, it's not fair for you to be able to just say what you think is because you're really missing a lot. You have no idea who it's going to offend. You have no, And I do. I'm being real careful with certain things. And, you know, the people who've reached out to me, it's really special.
Right. And
they were there a long time ago and get what things turned into a lot more with me.
With you. They took the journey along with you, which is a good feeling to have that go along. When you talk about the journey with your grandfather, Carl, what are some of those memories that you have about Carl? We all should only hope to live as old as Carl Reiner and his best friends, Norman Lear and Mel Brooks. And I mean, it's amazing.
It's laughter. He did more things that on the sly, like I did a horror movie and he showed up at the premiere. And then he said, you know, I'm really proud of you. And it's brave that you did this and you're out there exploring. And even though your parents separated, I'd be really happy if you kept the Reiner name. And I was like, the only person I knew there was like Bud Cort. I was like, come over here. And he just said like the nicest thing to me. Not that I didn't appreciate my horror movie cast and crew, but they weren't family friends. And so there's a really great picture of him coming to that event. And then he taught me to not be afraid. He taught me not to be terrified of charades when I came from, you know, Lab Family, Jehovah's Witnesses in Albuquerque to, you know, Barbara Bain and Martin Landau's house and these very loud, articulate, funny people. So he had this bathroom and I'd never seen anything like it because I'm sure your grandma's bathroom's like my grandma's bathroom and it's just the bathroom.
Right.
I walked into his bathroom at the bottom of the stairs. It wasn't even his bedroom bathroom. And there were so many things in there and books and plants and pictures and magazines. And you could look out the window into this Beverly Hills driveway and see this other amazing house. And it was the teeniest room when they would get really loud when I was a kid. And I would go into that. And it was an entire world to me. Like that was the first thing I think I ever saw of collecting.
And I think, you know, what's interesting, we all got a glimpse into that world when he did the reenactment of Princess Bride during COVID. We got a little glimpse into the world of...
just how nice everybody put forth the effort and enthusiasm at all times.
Right.
You know, Garry was very much life is more important than show business. Carl was always looking for material and finding the funny. And then Carrie would say, if you don't find the funny, then it's just true. And that's unacceptable. And my mom would say, I'm dying of funny already. And everybody had a little bit of a different take. And I had a lot of parents and, you know, my Uncle Fish, Carrie had me call her.
Right.
A lot of different voices in my head at all times.
Now, one time when I was covering the Paley Center for Media and they were doing a salute to Johnny Carson's show, your grandfather was there and he has a tie that has JC on it. Did he ever tell you the story behind the JC?
I don't remember.
Okay.
I'm over 50 now. I don't remember. Tell
me. Because he told me this wonderful story.
Can you see that? What does it say?
It says JC.
It's not Jesus Christ because he didn't own the tie. This is Johnny's tie. I stole it from him when he was sitting here. He doesn't know I have it.
That's your grandfather, is it not?
That's really funny. You have to understand, it was a constant running routine of commentary.
Right.
And unless you had, you would just watch and be like, wow. it takes a long time to, it's like jump rope to be able to even try with stumbling. And I watched a lot of people come up from being like interns or writing partners into being some of the premier talent, funny people in the world. That was amazing. That was really an education of how much your brain can expand and how amazing we actually are because it's all invisible. It's all just,
right.
It's beyond improv.
There was such a connection from all your family members with Norman Lear. What has been your connection over the years with Norman and how have you enjoyed, which is once again, Emmy nominated on The Family for ABC that Norman and Jimmy Kimmel have produced together?
Last spring, it became an Emmy-winning phenomenon.
Ooh.
This Wednesday, we're doing it again.
What?
As a live holiday event.
It's a surprise, Archie.
All in the family at good times. With an all-star cast, Woody Harrelson, Marissa Tomei, Viola Davis, Andre Brower, Tiffany Haddish, Kevin Bacon, and so many more.
Don't try to butter me up, I eat it.
Anything can happen when you're live in front of a studio audience.
It's amazing. I mean, live is a whole world in itself, but that was so absorbed as a construct of a landscape that it's amazing that it could be done live. I worked on Saturday Night Live for 3 seasons, which my mom said, here, Lorne Michaels, she'll help you. Don't put her on the show, just she'll help you. So I got to take everybody to the green room, and, you know, Tina Fey was just an intern too.
Love it.
Learn how things worked with him, but he's been a part of different things I volunteered for over the years. It would be like events at his house, and we'd go and listen to him talk, and he's incredibly prolific. And Rob moved in and bought his old house.
Right.
And he was sort of the one outside our family who was a different kind of austere uncle, especially for Rob. And I didn't have as much contact. It was more like Carl gave my Uncle Garry his first job, who in turn gave Rob one of his first jobs, who in turn then Garry gave my mom. It, you know. Lorman was already famous.
Right.
He was already, he had his own family and his own thing that I think they learned a lot from. Like, I'm friends with everyone's kids.
Right. Absolutely.
I know everyone's kids.
Isn't that the beauty of being in the position that you are with your mom's legacy, that you can keep the positive energy and the fun and the laughter and everything that you know that your mom would have stood for and continue that legacy, whether it be an auction, whether it be something professional, whether it be a documentary, a story of the family, whatever. It's been trusted into great hands, Tracy.
Well, she appreciated that I went off and learned a lot of things. She was mad that I didn't want to do more. But there is, you need to have some respect for the people you work with. And I knew them all way too personally to have just a blind, especially my peers. I have a little issue with what's going on now. I'm waiting. I can finally look at television now with my things my children watch, who are 14 and 15, and I don't know anyone. That's amazing.
That is amazing. I agree with you.
And then I can look at it for what it is and go, uh-oh, what are you guys doing?
but
it's very hard to when you know people and you kind of have to like it. It's their livelihood. You want to support them. And that's a little bit weird because when you look at entertainment separately, just as like media studies, and you don't know anyone in it, it's terribly lacking.
Right.
And it's not honest. And you don't really need my perspective to see that, but it helps. And it's blatant. There's so much constructed narrative, I'm having issues now. And so I'm going to just pause.
I understand that. But you also, there are people that had no idea who your mom was, who Henry Winkler was, who Cindy was, who your uncle was. I mean, we could go list on list, Carl, until they hit COVID. And they got stuck in their homes. And they started watching Netflix or Amazon or Hulu or whatever and seeing who these great comedic legends really are.
Before it's too late. Yeah.
Right.
I mean, that's really the future, right? Is archives.
True.
But it's not necessarily stuff because now, like I had someone, one of my friends who does CGI goes, I can render Zoltar. You can keep him forever. He can be a hologram in the corner, not get rusty. You don't have to dust it. Change the light bulb. It's not that much, but it's we're changing. We are changing and people's perspectives and ability to comprehend isn't long and luxurious now. It's a very short and very pointed.
True. We got to get back. You've got the big auction September 13th and people can learn more about it at able.com. and there's going to be some incredible lamps and other artifacts. Now, will we see different stages coming out as well as the year goes on too in the auctions?
I think they have a few different lots that they couldn't do all at once. There would be too many pages. I know there was 1,500 things, and that's nothing to what there still is. So we're not going to auction the rest. They actually go certain places, and it'll be a little more constructed, or I'll donate in a certain moment of need to something. But I think they have to, because I was like, where's all the cigar label ashtrays and things? And they're like, no, it's in lot B and C. So I think, I'm not exactly sure, I can't give you the entire breakdown. I just know that it's online. You can scroll through it. It's online only, but it is international. We're trying to get the word out everywhere. And as long as the mail and the shipping and FedEx are still working, it should be fine.
And they should go to www.abell.com.
A-B-E-L-L.com.
www.abell.com. And the auction starts. And does it end as well on September 13th?
No, I think it goes through the week. Okay. And then I'm not sure how the other lots are coming in, or I'm not sure.
Well, once again, thank you, Tracy Reiner. This is BJ Korros with the Hollywood Moment at Home Edition. Tracy, how can people follow you in social media and keep up with the latest and greatest of everything you're working on?
I am on Facebook as myself. I am on Twitter, but I'm not really a big Twitterer. I can be reached at the Women's Club of Hollywood. I am their president, and that's in Los Angeles.
And we need to remind everyone to learn more about the auction. They can go to www.abell.com. The auction begins on September 13th for an amazing collection of Penny Marshall. And thank you so much, Tracy, for being a guest today on the Hollywood Moment at Home Edition.
I had a lot of fun talking to you. I appreciate it.
And please follow me on Twitter. You can do so at TalkBlogGuy, or on Instagram at The Hollywood Moment. Until next time, this is BJ Korros. You're watching The Hollywood Moment at Home Edition. If you like the video, hit the like button and do subscribe.